I think this is it. It's time for Frank, who will, well, talk more about Nextcloud and all the big stuff that I have been teasing on Twitter in the last week. So, here you go, Frank.
Cool. Thanks. So, thanks, everyone. Welcome to the 2019 Nextcloud conference, also on my side. Let's all give a bit of applause. I think it's really cool to be here every year. Again, for me, also big thank you to the TU Berlin for hosting us. This is a really, really, really nice event. What's really special about this event, for my opinion, is that it's a community event. I mean, we have some, of course, some customers and some companies here, but at the end of the day, this is here at the weekend. So most of the people here are actually here as a volunteer and because they really like Nextcloud and like the community. So this is not like a paid event. This is really like a grassroots enthusiast event. I find this very, very nice. So most important from my side. So, of course, you might ask the question, why are we here? I mean, why do we spend our weekend here? What is so special? What is so interesting about Nextcloud? Why don't you do something else, like whatever, go to the park or whatever? Why are you here? Right? What is the what's the reason for that? And I think the main reason is that there are some challenges in the world, specifically in the IT world at the moment. So there is this term that you might have heard, that data is the new oil. Some people say that, data is the new oil. What is meant with that? You all know oil and how important it is for our industry, for our society, of course. And the theory here is that data is basically the new oil of the future. So the companies, the countries, the people who control the data of the future, they are basically have similar power to the people who control the oil nowadays. And we all know how many conflicts and wars were basically triggered by oil. So the theory is that data becomes as important as the oil of the future. Of course, we all know the countries who export the oil at the moment. We all can mark them on a world map, I guess, right? I made a little bit of, spent a little of time and took a world map and I marked all the places where the data is actually produced and stored and owned. But I was really quick with this map because it basically looks like that. So, I mean, this is Silicon Valley, right? There is like Dropbox and Facebook and Google and a little bit north is Amazon and Microsoft. And they are basically the big cloud companies. They're basically the companies who store and process most of the data on this world. And the question is if this is really good like that, if this is really useful, or if we need to change something here. And I actually think there are a lot of challenges with this situation. So first of all, it's a real centralization of power, really a lot of dependencies there. Security is a question. Is my data is really secure there? What about privacy? The reason is that most of those companies are making their money with advertising, right? And if you make money with advertising, well, then you don't really have a strong interest in protecting the data because you actually, this is how you make money. Democracy is a question because if everybody depends on one country, for controlling all the data and the communication, maybe this is not so healthy for the future. Then from an economic perspective, there's the vendor lock-in question, of course, right? If you like buy one of those services, then you don't have any choice. You can't escape it. There's no way out. And of course, from an innovation perspective, if you like a country like Europe or any country beside the US, if you want to have a local software industry and you want to innovate, then it's really difficult because what you can do with these cloud services, you can become a customer, you can become a user, but you can never basically really build or really not really replace it or build on top of that. You're just a customer. So this is, of course, a challenge. And I think this is a challenge for all of us and something we want to improve with Nextcloud. So what is special about Nextcloud? Is it just another cloud? Is it just another software? And of course, there are some fundamental differences. First of all, you can look at the mission or the mission of Nextcloud. And the mission is Nextcloud is we develop software for decentralized and federated clouds as an alternative to centralized cloud services. Okay, this is what we do. And there are a few things in there which are really important. First of all, we develop software. Right? Some people might think that we are a cloud service. We are not. We don't have any servers. We just do the software to enable you to build up your own services. And it's all about decentralization. Decentralization and federation as alternative to the big cloud services. So this is what we do. And we achieve this, or we want to achieve this, with certain principles. So after a lot of discussions, with a lot of people after some time, we came up with a list of principles that we want to follow. The first is that this is built for sustainability. So Nextcloud is not just another quick startup that is sold to someone next year and then some investors make money, but this is all set up to be a sustainable long-term company. So the founding group, like as you might know, Nextcloud was founded by 12 people originally. We all founded this idea, this project, this company, because we wanted to have something where we all want to work at, and we all want to work here for the next 10, 20, 30 years. This is not just a normal startup that disappears next week. So this is a sustainable thing. Privacy and security is super important for us. So everything we do follows the principle that we want to protect the privacy of the users and the security. We have more about this later, but this is really, really, this is the core of everything. User-centered design is super important, right? And there's so much software out there, which is quite powerful, but no normal user can actually use it, and then it becomes sort of useless, I think. And the mission of Nextcloud is to do something which really fun to use, easy to learn, really good for everybody. So user-centered design is super important. Open source, of course. We are committed, like everything, to be a 100% open source company, which means everything we do is open source. There is no software that we produce which is not open source. That's very, very important. Also, we have a open source business model, right? The company makes actually money with open source. There are some other companies who say, yeah, we are an open source company now, but if you look at how they actually make their money, they make their money with proprietary extensions. But we are a real open source company. Trust is really important. This is something that might sound like obvious, but from my perspective, this is really key because this is also how we work together with the bigger community. Because people ask sometimes, okay, you have like all these volunteers and together you write this software. How do you know if they don't do anything bad? Well, we really open and we really trust people. Of course, there are some review processes and there are some things to make sure that there are no security problems and other things, but we really open and trust the contributors and the volunteers and our partners. And this is really how together we can win. Open standards, we follow all open standards as much as possible, from WebDAV to ActivityPub to CalDAV, CarDAV, a lot of other standards. So if there's a standard, we always use it. If there's no standard, well, we have to invent our own APIs, which is stated and documented and proposed as an open standard. So this is really, really important. Decentralization, right? There is no part of Nextcloud which is centralized somehow. Everything is decentralized. That's our mission. We want to decentralize the infrastructure. Community is really important, so we really do all the stuff in the open on GitHub specifically. So even our website, it's actually a bit of sort of crazy, but actually our nextcloud.com website is developed in the open by community people. And we get like pull requests and patches from volunteers who improve the website. And even the design of our website is done by a volunteer. So this is really mind-blowing for some other companies, but we are really, really open here, community-oriented. Inclusion and diversity is super important. We believe that this makes us a better team if we are inclusive and we want to improve the diversity, so this is absolutely important. Accessibility, we really believe that everybody should be able to use the software, even independent from their capabilities. Okay, so these are our principles. Of course, it's really easy to have like these high goals, right? And then the question is, okay, what do you actually achieve there? And I think we can look a little bit back. Nextcloud is like 3.5 years old now, roughly. And let's look a little bit back what we did so far. So first of all, I'm really proud about our software, our product. I can talk about this in a few other slides later. But I really think if you take everything together we have at the moment, I think we are one of the most advanced Office 365 alternatives. And the same is for Google Suite, of course. There are no other software which is that advanced and is open source and runs on-premise. So this is really our unique thing behind Nextcloud. Run wherever you want. I mean, Nextcloud really runs from a small, tiny Raspberry Pi at home up to a huge cluster of 100,000, or the biggest installation is actually 20 million users. And this is the same software, so it really runs from very small to very big. But the point is that the users can decide where the data is stored. Right, you can look at the software, what Nextcloud can do, and maybe you like the features, and then you decide, okay, I want to run this at home or in the hosting center of my company or at a trusted certified service provider, or maybe you choose to run it on AWS or somewhere else, but you have the choice. And you can, of course, later migrate it around. If you start with one service provider and you don't like it anymore, just move to a different one. No problem. You keep your software and you keep your data. It's not possible with anybody else. 100% open source, as I mentioned already. Everything is 100% open source. And of course, this leads us to having one of the biggest open source communities. Sometimes we forget this, but we have around 2,000 people who contribute code to Nextcloud, not even counting translations and packaging and promotion and other things, and not even the third-party ecosystem apps. Right? Just in our repositories, we have like over 2,000 people actually contributing code, which makes Nextcloud one of the biggest open source projects out there. I think we have very first-class security processes and features. We learn a little bit later the details about that here, but I think we are really, really up to the highest standards here. The usability and the UX is great. I have some examples later. And we really have a lot of users. I mean, if you talk to our update server, we have one server which Nextcloud servers ask for updates, and there we can roughly estimate. We don't track any users or servers, of course, but we roughly estimate that we have over 300,000 servers out there, so 300,000 installations out there. And an installation, as I said, might be a Raspberry Pi or might be a huge government, just an installation. And there we also estimate we have about 25 million users. So this is quite a lot, especially because Nextcloud is so young. So, and I think because we do all those work and improve all those things, our users really, okay, really notice what we are doing. And I collected some things. First of all, some quotes from Twitter, from our community, and they're really nice quotes. It really comes from, hey, it gives me the opportunity to get into open source. Some people say Nextcloud is the best solution for my own cloud. There's smooth upgrades, the stability. People really like what we're doing. And if you go to YouTube, for example, just go to YouTube for fun and look for Nextcloud, you have videos like that right here. Here are 5 reasons why I love Nextcloud. It's really, really nice. So we really have a lot of happy users. This is really, really nice to see. Of course, they're not only home users, there are also a lot of bigger companies and organizations who trust in Nextcloud. So we have the German government, we have the French government now, there are companies like Siemens, there's RD, the German television, there's Amnesty International, the Red Cross, and many, many more. I mean, we have like lots of those organizations who use it. These are just some examples. And also, if you talk with the press also likes what we are doing. There are some quotes from here, the Windows Report, for example, the best free cloud software for Windows you can choose. Or here the Spiegel wrote, Nextcloud is a counter model to the typical cloud offerings from large US providers such as Microsoft. Or Finanzen.net wrote like how a German startup trumps cloud giants like Microsoft, Google, and Amazon. So this is really nice that we recognize what we're doing here. Okay, so this is all nice, but I think we want to look forward now. Let's not celebrate the past too much. I'm really the person who looks forward, and I think we want to move forward. And today, of course, the first thing I wanted to talk about is the next big step for Nextcloud, which is obviously Nextcloud 17. So if you know, Nextcloud 16 was released just a few months ago, but we are moving forward really, really fast. So 16 is the next big release that I want to talk about today. As always, we focus on three areas, like productivity. It should be really like nice, usable software, as I mentioned before. Speed and scalability is very important, and also security, because only if everything comes together, only then it becomes a good solution for everybody. So let's start with productivity. So productivity, we have a lot of functionality already in Nextcloud. I mean, most of you might see and might know this web interface here. You have your files, you can upload, download them, you can share them, you can tag them, you can search for them, delete, undelete, rename, share with others, comment about them. You can do a lot of things. It's a really powerful way to manage your files. Enterprise files you can share solution, basically. But of course, there's more. There's also Nextcloud Talk, which is our communication product. So that's a way to chat and to audio and video calls with other people. And you can do this in smaller groups or can do big groups as a webinar, can do screen sharing, can do a lot of things. And we even have mobile apps. Here on the right-hand side, you can see a screenshot of a mobile app. So you can also do everything on the phone if you want to. That's very powerful. And the third thing is obviously our groupware. So this is super popular. We have a calendar and contacts and email integration and a Kanban board, project management. So a lot of ways to do groupware. But of course, we don't want to stop there. So we really improve in a lot of areas. One is that we launched lately is this project feature. Because you notice that we have all these different capabilities, like chats and files and calendars and everything. But there should be a way to tie this closer together. So this new project feature, I don't know if you can see it, but on the left-hand side, you see files. In the middle, what is that? That's the project. And here they have a chat. And you can all group this together. You can say this chat channel belongs to this shared folder, belongs to this shared calendar, belongs to this Kanban board. And you can basically, as a team, then group every resources together across different apps. Well, this is very powerful to organize your work. Then the next thing I wanted to mention is social. That's a new feature that we launched a few months ago. This is about social networking, but also social networking into your organization. You can use this as a company, a group, a university social network, or even outside with everybody. And that's working because it's using the Mastodon compatible API called ActivityPub. So you can really like a federated social network, and you can post photos and files across all the Nextcloud servers out there. And now I want to give you a live demo of one of the coolest features we have at the moment, which is called Nextcloud Text. So let me see, 1 second. Can you see it? Okay, cool. So this is the Nextcloud interface as I described it. Right here on the top, you have your navigation of the different components. Here you can select on your different files that you shared with others, or you have your favorite and so on. And of course, here's the plus button that you can use to create a new file. Okay, so you can do different things, upload a file, create a folder, create like an office document, a spreadsheet, and so on. But what I'm doing here today is do this new text document. So I pick a name, call it test file. Okay, and what happens now is that I'm inside an editor, and this is a markdown editor, and I can do different things here. Where's the navigation bar? Okay, whatever. I can edit a document here, and I can, let me see, do a bold text, or I can do a list here. So you can basically edit a rich document here. And this is a markdown document. I don't know how many of you know markdown, but it's very cool because it's actually a normal text file, but you can structure your text like that. And the cool thing is, of course, I can then close it, and it's just a normal text file. And this is then, of course, immediately synchronized to all my other devices, synchronized to my phone and my desktop. And I can open it with local Markdown editors, because there are lots of Markdown editors out there for all platforms. Okay, but let's go back into it. So here's again my document. And what I can do now too is I can open this sidebar here, and I can see what versions here exist. And I can see there's already different versions of the file. I can roll back if I made a mistake, or I can see some activities, what I did with the file, leave a comment, and do other things. But what's really cool, what's very interesting is, of course, I can also share this file with others. Let's go to sharing here. And I want to share it with Julius, who is sitting here in the audience, and he is actually the main developer of this app. And if I click on this in this input line, you can see already some suggestions. So this is some machine learning features that we developed like lately, where we suggest like different users that are you probably want to share this document with. Okay, let's type Julius, and here Julius here. Click. And then we can see here in the list that he has now access to the file. And I can here, for example, say if it should be read-only or edit rights. But in this case, I give him edit rights. So he's also like here in the same document now. And now if I type, oh, you can already see Julius typing here. Okay. So this is actually collaborative editing of a Markdown file in Nextcloud. So this is like a full Markdown editor, which is works collaboratively. I can also type here, and he made something bold here at the top. So this is super, super useful. And again, I can close it and sync it to my phone later and sync it back and keep on working on it. So it's super, super flexible there. Okay, but of course, because Julius is might be not in the same room, but somewhere else, we need to coordinate what we are doing here. And for that, you can click on the chat button here. And then I actually have a chat with the people who are editing the same document at the same time. Okay, here, Julius joined the conversation too. Say hi. So we can actually chat here and really work together on the same document. And this is not limited to two people. You can have as many people as you want working on the same document together. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Okay, but I mean, chatting is nice, but of course you might actually want to directly talk with the person. And now I have this start call button here that I can press. Let's see what happens now. Oh, now if you actually have a video call. Yeah, so this also works with more people. It's not limited to two people, but we can actually have a video call. I have switched off audio here; it would be a bit too confusing. But we have a real call with several people with a chat where you work collaboratively on a document, and this is super useful for like meeting notes or other things. And that's a very very powerful feature. And again, it's not limited here to the web interface. You can also keep on working on Mac, Windows, Linux, iOS, Android. They're very nice Markdown editors too. Okay, cool, then thanks a lot. And let's go back to the slides. Okay. So next feature I want to mention is that sometimes this Markdown editor is not enough. Sometimes you want to work with Office documents, Microsoft Office documents or LibreOffice documents. And for that, I'm happy to say that we have the very same feature also for Office documents. This requires software from partners. And we have two partners here, and they're also both here at the conference with Collabora Online and OnlyOffice. And they both provide plugins for Nextcloud that can be integrated into Nextcloud that you can edit Microsoft Word, Excel, PowerPoint documents directly in the browser, and again, also collaboratively, and again, also with the chat sidebar and with the video call. And this is super powerful. I'm actually very, very proud and happy about this feature because no one else can do that. And even like Microsoft, I mean, they have like Skype for Business and Teams and other stuff, but this happens in a completely different window, and this has nothing to do with Word, and the same for Google and all the others. But we actually have this super nicely integrated. You just go to your document that you want to edit, you share it with a group of people. Some people even can send out a public sharing link. You don't even need an account on the server. And you click on it, and you edit a document, and directly you have the chat, and you have the video call, nothing to configure. And this is very, very powerful and very, very useful feature for productivity. Now let's talk a little bit about Nextcloud Talk, which is our communication product. You saw a little bit about it already, that you can do integrating into other things, but we also actually improved it a lot lately. Here is an example of some of commands and chatbot integration, basically. So you have this feature that inside the Nextcloud Talk channel, you can execute some commands. Maybe you can do /Wikipedia or something, and then it automatically calls a script which queries Wikipedia and posts the results back into the chat channel. Or you have like a simple example of a calculator on top. And this is very, very useful if you integrate this inside your organization. Maybe you have some ERP system, maybe you have some vacation planning tool, something. And you can actually integrate commands here where you can do everything then in a chat channel. It's very powerful integration. The last thing we added, like the latest version, is a lobby, because at the moment there's just a call room and you go to the room and everybody has a meeting and then leaves the room again. But sometimes you really want to have a specific start date. You want to have a real webinar or something where the moderator configures a start date and say, okay, at this time the meeting starts, and then all the participants, they can go to the room and they see then this waiting sign. They see, okay, the call hasn't started yet. There's a date where you can see it's counting down until the start date, and then when the date is reached, the call starts and we have the meeting. It's a very, very nice feature. Another feature that we launched in the last series is an integration on the public sharing page. Let me explain what this is. So let's say I have a PDF. I have a PDF that I'm working on, and I want to send this PDF to other people. And I, as always, I can create like a share link and send it to someone, clicks on the link, and then basically sees the PDF, as you can see on the left-hand side. But now we also have Talk integrated on the sidebar. So let's say you have a document that you have to like review together with someone, just send the link, and you both jump into the chat or do a video call, and then you have a conversation with the people around this PDF. You can basically review the document together, and this works for all kinds of document formats. But it's, again, very useful to collaborate. Also outside your organization, right? The other person doesn't need an account on the server. Just a link, click on the link, and they can view the document and chat. And there are lots of more things. For example, the mentioning system with the push notifications to the phone is improved. We have a level indicator where people can see if they accidentally muted or not. There's a new backend which has a lot of better performance support for more browsers. So this is really, really getting a lot better. Okay, but that's not all. Now we have a lot more improvements in the area of usability and user experience and productivity. And for that, I want to ask Jan, our design lead, to show us a little bit more here.
Thank you. Yeah, so you already saw a bunch of the things that we worked on design-wise, text, talk, and more, really plenty of stuff that we worked on with the design team. And I want to highlight a few more things. So one of these is the polishing. We do this every release. We sit down in a room, we lock ourselves in for 2 to 3 hours or something, and look at a whole like new pre-release and see what are the small issues, what are the paper cuts that people would stumble over, and we make a giant list and then we fix it. And this time we fixed more issues than ever before. And a special shout out to Greta, who fixed probably at least half of these issues. And also thanks to everyone else who fixed any of these issues. So. And And another, like, it's a bigger polishing part is that we now use what is called a native font stack. So that basically means that whichever operating system you use, whether it's Windows or macOS or Android or Ubuntu or whatever, it will show with the font that is native to your system. So it looks like it's kind of more part of the system. So we also did that because the font that we were using, it had difficulties displaying a Cyrillic, for example, and other different alphabets. So we just went with this, which also, for example, is used by Twitter. You might have noticed that, yeah, it just looks, I mean, you actually don't notice it because it just looks normal, right? As so often in design, you don't notice it. So like there's some, these are, I don't know if you can see the difference. I mean, these are two different native fonts. Like, I think one is Roboto, one from Android, and the other one is GNOME. So yeah, you can barely see the difference, and that's kind of the point. It will look similarly on macOS, for example. It will always look nice. So another thing, also kind of polishing, is that we now have app recommendations. So one issue is that currently when you install Nextcloud, you have this kind of empty-ish top bar, and you have files, activities, and gallery there, but you kind of don't really know what Nextcloud really has to offer, like what lots of you app developers, for example, are doing. And so what we now do is for a new release, you get these like four main apps recommended, which is Calendar, Contacts, Mail, and Talk. So this will be seen by admins, and then yeah, you kind of just know that there's apps and that you can go to the app store. So when you click it, it will go to the deep link of the app, and this way we also kind of advertise the fact that there's lots more apps out there. So yeah, that people know what you all work on basically. More good news for app developers is, this, I found this slide in the dusty old slides from last year. This is how standardization looked last year. Lots of markup code didn't really look good. You needed to follow like special class instructions. You needed to use specific things, and this all changed now. This is it now. A lot simpler, a lot less code. It's now nice view components. So yeah, a special shout out to Bart, Julius, Christoph, and everyone else who has been working on that. Also, you may clap now. And the cool part is also you get stuff that is normally maybe a bit difficult, like accessibility, for example. You get that for free in these view components. And if you want to know more, participate or use them and see the documentation where this is listed, just go to the GitHub repository, to the Nextcloud view repository. And so, yeah, this is the web app part. But yeah, as you know, we're not only about web apps. So the last thing that I'm going to show you is something that we've been working on is cross-platform coordination. So making sure that all the apps, like our mobile apps, our desktop app, and the server side is all on feature parity. So you see in some areas, this is a bit of an, because we moved it to issues, this is a bit of an older table. So a bunch of this stuff is already fixed, but it's a nice overview of like where we still have work to do, and we're constantly working on making it feature complete on every platform so that you have the same experience wherever you are and everything is available. Yeah, wherever. Okay, that's it. Back to Frank.
Okay, thanks a lot. So this was the first part of the improvement of 17. The second area, as I mentioned, is speed. So of course, if Nextcloud wouldn't be performant, then what would be the point in the first place? So this is why we're constantly working on improving the scalability and speed and performance of Nextcloud. So overall, I'm really, really happy with the architecture we have because it's really scalable in the real sense of scalable. Scalability means that it's really something from very small to very big. And it's very small. For example, left-hand side, you see a Raspberry Pi. I mean, you always use Raspberry Pi as an example. I'm not really sure. I really would love to use Raspberry Pi as a server, but you could. Right? The software works on very, very small devices. And it works like up over Linux servers and clusters of Linux servers and bigger systems. And the right-hand side, you see a hosting center, which can serve like hundreds of thousands of users based on running Nextcloud. And this is actually the hosting center of DAISY. That's a particle accelerator who's actually using Nextcloud, that actually running it on those servers for a really huge amount of data. So it's really, really, really good here. But of course, we want to do a little bit more because we don't have hundreds of thousands of users, but we actually have millions of users. And the biggest installation that we are aware of has 20 million users. That's a big service provider. And for that, you really can't do this in one cluster anymore. And for them, we built an architecture called Global Scale. You can basically think about it as a cluster of clusters. And you can basically have different clusters distributed over different hosting centers on different continents, but they're still, with the help of Global Scale, work together as one service, as one instance. So, and of course, we're still improving this. For Nextcloud 17, we have improvements in the global site selector, which is one component, and we have the Collabora integration. So here I want to nerd out a little bit, sorry for that, but I think this is really, really cool, because what this means is you can basically collaborate on the same document with different people, while the people working on this document are actually hosted on different hosting centers on different continents. Right, so it can really completely distribute it, but still work together on the same thing. And this is really unique. I don't think anyone else, not even the big guys, have a similar feature like that. So this is really, really nice. Of course, we also improve. improve other components of Nextcloud. So this is the web interface. There's a lot of work going on to make it like snappy, more responsive, more faster. We moved to Webpack, for example, which helps like make it just a lot nicer and faster to use. Of course, there's also the storage integration, right? Because Nextcloud needs to store the files somewhere in the backend, and we have lots of different options for that. And one of the more popular options is, of course, the S3 Object Store connector. And this is a feature that exists for a long time, but in the latest release, we really also improved it a lot. So we introduced more streaming here, and the big new feature is native versioning support. So you can basically use the native versioning of the storage backend directly inside Nextcloud. This makes everything a lot nicer, and this helps with integrating with all kinds of storage systems like the Red Hat storage or SUSE Enterprise storage and other things. And of course, there are also other backends. So another very important backend is IBM Spectrum Scale. That's a partner from us. And we're working together for several months already to integrate Nextcloud better with the storage. And I want to ask Ulf from IBM to tell us a little bit more about that.
Already on. Yeah, okay. So we are working a while together, not basically me, but a colleague. But I volunteered here to come here the weekend, be here. So that is Spectrum Scale, is a scalable file system. Yeah, and that one is a leading edge sim system that we delivered last year with 250 petabytes. And the numbers in blue, that are the acceptance criteria. And you can sense there's a lot of activity in the file system. And if you configure that as external storage into Nextcloud, then you cannot scan the file system every 15 minutes or so to see what is going on. Yeah, that does not work at this scale. Yeah, and we have for that developed a feature for real-time notification. The activities in the file system, yeah, we scan it and push it into a Kafka system. And from there, other applications can pull out the events and do whatever they need to do certain things. Yeah, I visit the customer this week. They generate about 1 petabyte of new data from instruments. They do science. And they are using this feature to copy the data from an ingest file system within 1.5 seconds into an HPC file system and run there the analysis of the acquired data. Yeah, and after the results, and they desire to share the results with Nextcloud. Yeah, and with that new integration feature, they can build an end-to-end pipeline, ingest APC, HPC, and then after some time they can share the results like any other document. Yeah, and with this notification feature we have, we push the updates into Nextcloud via Redis and Memcache, so you no longer need to poll. Yeah, that doesn't work at this scale.
Okay. Thanks a lot. And I think there will be a lightning talk with more details about this later, in which scenario this can be useful. Double microphone, good point. Stereo. Okay, so let's talk about the third area, which is really important. This is security. And if Nextcloud wouldn't be secure, what's the point of it, right? So because this is security is a real focus of us. And we do a lot of improvements in a lot of areas. For example, something we added lately is support for access control lists, ACLs. So if you're really a big organization with a complex rights structure with different groups and so on, you can model your access rights here with ACLs. You can see it here in the screenshot a bit. You can really model, as you know from other platforms, access rights for subfolders. That's a very long-standing feature request. Second thing is, of course, our end-to-end encryption that we are launched a while ago, but we want to be really careful with that. We have it still basically in preview or in beta stage, but it's really working. A lot of people using it already, so it's a very interesting, powerful new feature if you really have documents that are really, really super secure. So then we come to another big announcement from today, and this is a feature request that exists forever, and this is remote wipe. So a lot of people want to wipe their devices if they lose their phone, for example. So far, our answer was, yeah, get a mobile device management solution. And we still do this. We still support it. We work together with a bunch of mobile device management solutions and companies. But today, I'm really happy to say that we also have our own remote wipe solution built into every single Nextcloud 17. That's a quite nice feature. It works like that. You basically have two modes. First, the admin mode. So this is the normal user management. You see the users there. And on the right side, there's this menu. You can click there, and you can just select or disable user, for example, but also wipe all devices. And this means that all devices that are connected by this user will be then, all the Nextcloud files will be then deleted from this device. Our second way is, of course, as a user. I have this device overview on Nextcloud, where you can see all your connected laptop, an iPad, and phone, and other devices. And I can say, okay, I still have my laptop with me, but my phone I left somewhere. And I can say, okay, I want to wipe only the phone, but still keep all my files on my other devices. And this is done very nicely because you get a push notification from the system once the wipe is done. Then you know, okay, there was internet access. Of course, I need network for that, obviously. And if it's done, you get a push notification. Okay, device is successfully wiped. And then, well, if someone opens the app, they just see a login screen and can't access any data. Next feature is secure mailbox. So this is very cool. This is a very innovative feature, which I also don't think exists anywhere else. So it actually works together with our Outlook plugin. As you might know, we have an Outlook plugin which integrates into Microsoft Outlook. Let's say I'm writing a mail to someone, and this mail should be very secure. And I have a text, and I also have an attachment there maybe, and type in the recipient, and I want to send this mail to the person, but I don't trust email, because as you know, email is not very secure. You can read it on the mail server, and there are other problems with it, but it should be really secure. Because of that, I click on our Outlook button, and then you get our normal Outlook interface, and there is this checkbox, secure mailbox. And if you check that, what happens then is then the, your mail, all the attachment is replaced by the standard text with a link. Okay, and then this mail is sent out like that, and the recipient can then click on the link and then see the mail and the attachment in the web interface. And this is, of course, then encrypted and secured with certificates and other things. And, of course, the authentication here can also happen with two-factor authentication. So this is basically, you could say, it's like a two-factor authentication for email. But this is a very, very interesting, cool new feature that we did with our partner, Asanti here, who developed this Outlook plugin. But this is, yeah, exactly. But But this is not all. There's a lot more improvements in the secure area. For that, I want to ask Ruland, our security lead, to tell us more about that.
Thank you. Is it on? Yes, perfect. Okay, so the one of the things, since I was last on stage, we have now is suspicious login detection. And what this does is say most of us are probably creatures of habit. So if we log into our Nextcloud environment, it's either at home or at work, most likely, or at your parents, girlfriend. But there are often known places. And what our suspicious login detection does, it collects this data and it trains a neural network. So if now, for example, there's a login to your account from South America or Asia, then, well, that's strange. So you get a push notification and an email saying that there was a new login from a location that's the system deemed suspicious. And well, if it was you, you know, because then you are at in South America on the beach and you needed to re-log in. But if it wasn't you, then you can quickly access your account and change your password to make sure that there's no sensitive data leaked. So as I said, we train a neural network to do this. But of course, here again, we care that it's your data, so all the training happens on your own instance. This happens in the background, all transparent to the user, but it never leaves your system. So we don't send it off to some big fancy company or even to us. It stays on your own server. Then, of course, to make sure that suspicious login detection doesn't even get triggered. We all have very long and secure random passwords for your account, which is something you know. But as most of you here are probably already aware, there has been two-factor authentication support in Nextcloud for a long time now. And your second factor is something you are or you have. So it can either be a token on your phone, or it can be a hardware key you plug into your system, things like that. And for a few versions now, we also have the enforcement of two-factor. So you can say, everybody on my instance needs to authenticate with its second factor or not, or only people of a certain group. So you want to make sure that the finance department always has second factor enabled. But as you, the ones of you who tried that might have seen, this wasn't ideal because it just locked out the users and you, the admin had to generate a one-time token and so on and so forth. So what we did in Nextcloud 17 is streamline this a lot. So if you now enable enforcement of two-factor authentication and a user that hasn't set up two-factor authentication before logs in, they get presented with this screen and they have to set up a second factor. And so the moment they do that, they have their second factor and their account is secured with this. So it's a way to streamline the process, to not burden the administrator and have a smooth transition to more secure accounts. The other thing we're introducing with Nextcloud 17 is Secure View. And this, because we know the feeling that you want to share something with somebody, but you want to make sure that they don't get the file. You just want them to view what they're doing, what you share to them. And for this, we have several options that you can. One of the easy things is that we don't show the download option anymore. So it's only shown in a dedicated viewer. But that, of course, leads to the problem we all know from a lot of software that well, it's just annoying and you could still press print screen. Of course, for this, we also introduce with secure viewing watermarking. So you can add your own watermark, which is then respected in a number of apps. And well, as you can see on the screen, there are numerous options for when you want to do secure viewing, when you want to have the watermarking enabled. So that would then look something like this. This is a screenshot from Collabora. So we see here that the watermark is printed in several places. So if you do a screenshot, it's still you can trace it back to that it was your file accessed at this date. And I recently heard that this is also soon available in our OnlyOffice plugin. Oh, well, so outdated information already there even. So that then makes it possible to share your Office documents or PDF files or images in a more secure way if you want to make sure that they stay your images. Then, as I've talked about on this stage a few times before, we run a bug bounty program at HackerOne, which means we invite hackers from all over the world to check out our software, and they have a secure and easy way to notify us of vulnerabilities they find. We have been running this since the beginning of Nextcloud, and it works. We get high quality reports that we then act upon that make the software more secure. And I'm proud to announce that today, or well, Jos beat me to it by a day, but we're doubling all the bounties of our program. So the maximum bounty, even though we never had to pay it. That helps, but it's now $10,000 and all the other... this means that if somebody actually finds something that critical, which again didn't happen so far, and we're pretty confident it won't, but if they manage to find something big, they get even better monetary rewards. So we hope that encourages everybody to do responsible disclosure and help make Nextcloud safer. And that's it. Back to Frank.
Okay, that's very cool. So if someone wants to look into our software and finds a security problem, you can make some money. But as Roland said, didn't happen so far. I think we're really confident about the security because that we are increasing the bounty, of course. Okay, so security is very, very key. As I mentioned before, and as Roland explained, this is very important for us, because if the security wouldn't be good, then that wouldn't make any sense. So because that, we implement a lot of security features. Some of them we heard today, but of course we did a lot more security features in the past. And because of that, I think it's really cool that a lot of those things actually come together. Some of you might know that there's a product category called Virtual Data Room. So this is a product category that is used for super secure, high sensitive collaboration. So this is done sometimes if you really like, one big company negotiates with someone else, or like if a government negotiates with another government for very high secure ways to collaborate. And I'm really happy that a lot of things actually come together. And because of that, I'm happy to announce that we together launch a new product called Nextcloud Virtual Data Room. It comes together with Nextcloud 17. And this is a product which really helps for super high secure collaboration. So, thank you. So this is actually interesting, because a lot of the stuff we did last few years and also like now with 17 actually comes together to form the foundation of this product. So of course we, as I showed earlier, we can collaborate around documents like Markdown or Microsoft documents or LibreOffice documents. We have the secure authentication, the two-factor secure authentication that Roland showed, which helps to make sure that only the right person can access it. There's a suspicious login neural network feature, which helps to make sure that no one else logs into your system. There's an auditing log where you can actually check who accessed which file when. The end-to-end encryption feature that I mentioned, the secure view the view only feature and the watermarking feature and also the remote wipe. And because everything comes together, I think we are actually one of the best products in this area. But again, I want to stress, this is just at the end of the day, this is just Nextcloud 17, right? And again, this is just all open source again. So you all can have this basically now. This is not like a weird like product which is somehow special or needs special configuration or something. This is just everything we do, again, open source and available for everybody. Okay, but so far I talked mainly about the server, but of course we also have very, very powerful clients. Let's talk a little bit about our clients. Let's get started with the desktop client. I'm happy to announce that we have a 2.6 release of our desktop client nearly done. There's a release candidate available today. It has a better login flow. It is more compatible with some SSO solutions, and it, of course, supports the remote wipe feature that we showed earlier. And there's also a new preview of the virtual try feature also available today for everybody. This is a feature where you can see all the files in your Nextcloud, even if they don't fit into your local hard disk. So this is a feature we're working on since a few months, and we're making really, really nice, good progress. And there's another preview today, and we hope that we can release the final very, very soon about that. And of course, there's a lot of improvements in the mobile app. Here, Android, for example, we already support like trash bin, media streaming, and searching, and a lot of other things. And of course, remote wipe now also. You can also like your Android apps will be wiped, as I said earlier. And we also have Chrome OS support. So if you want to have a Chromebook, for example, this is also now fully supported with Nextcloud. And the iOS app, we also have a ton of improvements. We have better notifications. We have a better file provider for multi-user accounts, a better share view. You can really do everything you can do in the browser. You can also do on the phone. That's super powerful. The activities notification is better. And, of course, we also have a dark mode now, which is very cool. Oh, that. Some fans of the dark mode. Yeah. No, this is very cool because, as you might know, there's iOS 13 coming out next week, and just in time, we fully support this, of course. Okay, so when do you get all of that? Everything I just showed you is like available today as a release candidate, and the final will be out in 2 weeks. But you can test all of that. You can all download all of that today. Everything, again, is open source. Just go to our download page, download it and test it, everything we showed you here today. And the final, as I mentioned, in 2 weeks. So you just look for the final testing. I don't know if there's some polishing left, but it's basically done and you can use it today. But I want to do another special preview today. So usually, as you might have noticed, we together decided that we only want to show you features that are basically done, that are available today, and not so much speculate about the future, that everything might be awesome in the future. We will talk like others might do. We basically only talk about stuff that's available today. But here I want to make a little bit of an exception and talk about a very cool feature, in my opinion. And this is called Nextcloud Flow. And this is actually a new workflow component. So we're introducing a workflow tool in Nextcloud, which is very powerful and flexible. And there are some use cases. I want to go through some use cases for now. So maybe you want to automatically create a PDF based on a file that's uploaded. Or maybe you want to get a push notification every time your colleague changes a specific Excel file. Or maybe you want to send a message into a specific talk channel every time a specific file is like renamed or whatever, something happens. Or you want to call an external script. In a lot of organizations, you have external scripts for some data analysis or other things. You can call this automatically if something specific happens. Or you create like an entry in the DEC app, like, you know, it's a project management tool we have, or a calendar entry, or you start a full approval workflow if something specific happens, like a vacation request in a specific folder or something. So lots of use cases that are very popular where you can do a lot of automation there. And it actually looks like that. I think our UI team made a really good job with working on that. So the first thing you see is this nice overview of actions, of things that happen. You can first decide, I want to have a notification or mail or some other thing that might happen. And you select this. And the second thing you do after that, you define the conditions. I don't know if it's easy to see, not really, but you can define basically when those actions happen. You can say, okay, when someone of this LDAP group touches a file that is tagged with this tag at that time from that device in that folder, then do something. There are a lot of complex rules that you can define. And here you can see there are already a few rules. There's the green, red, and blue. There are three different rules already. And this can be defined as an administrator or also by an individual user. So a user can model their workflows, or an administrator can also define it. And I'm really happy that this is not just a preview that we plan to do, but this actually exists already today. So if you want to test this, you can test this today. And we have on our download page a link to what we call the daily master. This is a daily build of our main development branch. You can go there and you can test this out already today. And it will be part of the next release, Nextcloud 18, that comes out later. This will be final there, but this is already working today. And I hope that some of you might be motivated to implement more actions or come up with new ideas and new conditions to make this even more useful. And I know that there is another talk, a workshop about this later today, where you can learn more how this works and how you can extend the system. And I think it can be just super, super powerful and really productive for a lot of organizations. Okay, this leads me to the last thing I wanted to talk about today, and this is our developer program. Because if you saw the presentation so far, you might think that Nextcloud is just a nice product. That's true, it's a nice product, but it's also a platform. So Nextcloud is also a platform where you can build on top of. And this is something that's very important, because integrating with other software is absolutely super, super important here for us. And for that, I'm happy that today we are launching a new developer program to make this like easy as possible for everybody. So first of all, we have this new website called nextcloud.com/developer. You can go there, you can see links to all the documentation of all different APIs. You have example code. You can create a new plugin. There's a wizard for that. You can basically fill in a few IDs and you get already your basic app download, and you can fill in your business logic, and then you have a Nextcloud plugin, and there's a way to talk with other developers on the forum and to get in contact with us if you want to do shared marketing around your plugin. So there are lots of options where we want to help you to extend Nextcloud, but also integrate Nextcloud into your other software. But that's something that's very important. And this is important for industry partners. So we work together with a lot of other organizations, projects, and companies. OnlyOffice, of course, Collabra, Moodle, RocketChat, now also IBM, and NitroKey. There's something in your bag. So we work together with a lot of organizations, and there are many more, actually. But this is not only for companies. This is also for our community. And as I mentioned, our community is just super important. So we have an app store of over 200 extensions and apps. That store is misleading. It's all free and open source, of course. But this is a place where everybody in the community can publish their extension. And this is something that's really important. And we hope that we have more and more of those apps thanks to this new developer program. And to push this forward, we did an app development contest lately where we encourage people to write cool apps for Nextcloud. And I want to hand over the thing to Nina to tell us more about this cool context that we did lately. Oh, Marinella, of course. Yeah, sure. Thank you.
So does this work? Yeah. As Frank was saying, we have a kind of a huge app ecosystem. As of today, it is like 200 apps, mostly maintained and developed by community. So that actually means like that still works. Yeah, that means that like hundreds of people are contributing to develop apps in their free time. That's really awesome. Just like, thank you. So yeah, earlier this year we decided to have like a friendly app contest so that people can showcase the new best apps that they really like to use. And Marinella organized it, so thank you very much, Marinella, for organizing the app contest. So we want to showcase today the five main apps that made it to the final contest. And the first one is external storage drive. So basically, maybe you use OneDrive, but you want to have the Nextcloud experience. And external storage OneDrive helps you while having your OneDrive as an external storage, but still using like the Nextcloud apps. So this was like really cool for Windows users. So then we have upload details. So basically it adds a bunch of nerdy details to your upload. Maybe you're interested in like the remaining time or the speed, and you don't have that like in the regular download app. So that's really cool for people who want to track it like really seriously. So the third one is quite useful for people who want to actually share stuff online, because you can have a link to your Nextcloud files, but this one is really like a path. So for instance, if you want to embed an image in a tweet or on your blog, you can use the sharing path app and it works really well. And then we go to dashboard charts. So you have your Nextcloud, you have all your files in your Nextcloud, but the dashboard charts that allows you to bring like the outside world to Nextcloud. Like you can just feed your Nextcloud with flows of data coming from basically anywhere. Like you can read like its carbon emissions on the top. You have also like I don't know music or even your sensors at home. So that's really like a big overview of all the data which is of interest for you. And then we will have a look at Maps, which actually won the app contest. So, first round of applause, please. And yeah, basically Maps is fitting the whole world into your Nextcloud. So you have maybe pictures of your travels. Maybe you have like contacts in, Germany, but also like in Europe and also in the rest of the world. You can show them and everything is, you can, track your devices, track your travels, and everything is in your secure place and private place for you to, you know, just play with it. And it actually also looks really nice, which is a huge plus. So Marinella, maybe like you can tell us more about the developers that made the app.
Julien was the main developer that developed the app, but sadly he couldn't be here today. Sorry. Julien couldn't be here today, but all the app developers of the Maps app are invited and welcome to join our future Nextcloud events like Nextcloud Conference. Like the Nextcloud conference. Okay, sorry again. They are welcome to join the next Nextcloud conference and all the other events like our Hack Weeks. Also, later this year, this week, we will publish a blog, an article, an interview with Julien that explains how he got involved, how he started developing the idea about Maps. And we are encouraging the new app developers that are still beginners to develop their own app for Nextcloud.
So yeah, we hope to do it next year also. So if you have, you know, an app idea, just come and chat with us. And great things can happen then. So back to Frank.
Thanks. Okay, thanks a lot. This is actually the end of the presentation. I hope it was interesting for you to give you an overview of what's going on in the Nextcloud world. But of course, this is only the beginning of our conference here. So we have, as you know, in the schedule, we have a lot of workshops and interesting talks and lightning talks and a party tonight and a lot of other activities. And of course, the opportunity to network and to talk to each other. I mean, a lot of the core developers and core people of Nextcloud are here for the weekend. And also, if you want to stay longer, like a hackathon the next week. So I hope really have a good time here. And thanks a lot. And let's make the world a little bit better together. Thank you.